Thank you very much for being here. It's a great honor and I love to talk to you. For about 30 years now, I feel a scientist. I work as a scientist. And it all started when I was, well, at high school, your age, at least younger age here. When I was about 16, there was a movie. It was from Carl Sagan. It's now a sort of rehearsal also for this movie. And I got this book for my birthday when I was 16. And I loved the book. It's really amazing. Carl Sagan, an astronomer, American astronomer, he talks about planets and galaxies and space travel. And he talked about atoms and molecules. And it was fascinating. I loved the story. I loved the book. I've read it many times. He also taught about the history of science, about Leonardo da Vinci and his inventions, and about Galileo Galilei, how he was looking at the moons of Jupiter. And I was doing the same at that age. With my binoculars, I was looking to the moons of Jupiter, and you can see them change every few days. He also talked about space travel and rockets and the development of rockets, and also about atomic bombs and how they were developed. He didn't talk about climate change, not about ozone layer depletion. And those are the subjects I've been working on for the past 20 years. He did talk somewhat about climate change, but in the sense that they thought in the 1980s that a nuclear war could give a nuclear winter. They would get it very cold because of all the dust in the atmosphere. I will talk now about climate change and ozone layer depletion. And yes, climate change is real. The previous speaker already said we have to do something about it, and that's completely right. We all have to do something about it. And not so much for me, but for my son, and hopefully for his grandchildren, or my grandchildren. That's the reason why I have to do something about climate change. What is climate change? We talk about the greenhouse effect. What is it, the greenhouse effect? It all starts with the sun. Radiation from the sun is hitting the atmosphere. Part of the radiation is radiated back directly because it hits clouds and small particles in the atmosphere and goes back into space. The other part hits the Earth's surface and warms the surface there. That's good, because we get it warm here, otherwise it would be far too cold. Part of the radiation, the warmth that we get from Earth's surface, is also radiated back into space. Also no problems, all fine. What's happening now, because there are greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, part of radiation that wants to go out back to the atmosphere is trapped there and radiated back to the surface. That's also a natural process, but since we get much more greenhouse gas in the atmosphere over the past 150 years, more and more radiation is trapped and is heating the atmosphere additionally. What's causing this? This is caused by man-made greenhouse gases. Man-made, but also natural, but especially man-made greenhouse gases. What this graph shows you, this shows over the past 800,000 years the concentration of CO2, the main greenhouse gas in the atmosphere. And you might wonder, how do we know what the concentration was 800,000 years ago? What scientists do, they go to Greenland and they go to the Antarctic. The ice there, the ice cap, is a few kilometers thick. And the ice that is, let's say, a kilometer below the surface, that is snow that has fallen there hundreds of thousands of years ago. And scientists drill a hole in there, they collect the ice, bring the ice up, and there are air bubbles in the snow, or in the ice. And the air bubbles is the air which is trapped there a few hundred thousand years ago. And you can measure the CO2 concentration in the small air bubbles. And that way, you can make the whole reconstruction of the temperature for the past 800,000 years. You see that the concentration varied between about 170 to 270 parts per million. That is molecules of CO2 per million molecules of air. And that was the natural variation we've seen over this past. And what you now see on the right there, that's not an error there, that's the concentration now. It's over 400 parts per million. So for 800,000 years, it was between 170 and 270, and the last 100 years is skyrocketing to a value over 400. And if we don't, well, whatever we do in fact, but if we don't act very fast, it will be over 500 in a few decades. This is causing the greenhouse effect. What do we see already of the temperature changes? This is a graph which shows the global average temperature on Earth, measuring everywhere on the surface and also by buoys on the oceans everywhere. So a reconstruction of the temperature, all measurements. And you see that the average temperature over the past 100 years globally was about 13.9 degrees Celsius. And now, since the last 30, 40 years, it's all in the red, it's all increasing, the temperatures. And now we are about 1 degree higher than the temperature over the past, average over the past 100 years. You can also see that 2014 was warmer than ever measured in the past century. 2015 was even warmer. 2016, again warmer. And now 2017 and 18 are not again a record, but still higher than they have been before. And I believe that 18 of the 19 warmest years on this record are all in the last, all past year 2000. So really, our Earth is warming. We also see, you see the sea level rising. There's also measurements of the sea level of several places of the world. And you see over the past century, sea level has risen by about 15 centimeters and is projected to continue to rise. And what's causing this? Well, when I show you the drought, I don't have to tell you about the drought we had last summer here. For according to the KNMI, that's not caused by climate change yet, but it is something which is indicative of a climate we're getting into. Droughts are more common, probably, maybe not here only, but in other places too. We see flooding. If you now open the newspapers, look on the internet, there's now heavy flooding in Iran, in Sydney, heavy flooding. So this is a real problem, a lot of places in the world already now. Maybe not exactly those events linked to climate change, but a warmer atmosphere will contain more water and will give you heavier showers. We also see the hurricanes. A warmer ocean, due to climate change, will give you more likelihood of hurricanes. And we now see it in Mozambique, where you have the hurricane and it's devastating there, the whole countryside. And a thing is often forgotten, also the oceans. The oceans are directly affected by it because CO2 gets into the oceans and makes them more acidic. And a more acidic ocean, well, if you have more acid in the oceans, the shells, the sea shell and the coral cannot grow very well because the shells are broken down by the acid. And that's affecting the whole food chain in the oceans. So also the CO2 in there, even if the climate would not warm, will give you large effects on the ecosystems. And of course, we also see the melting of the North Pole, the ice on the North Pole. The left side shows you the average in September when you have the least ice after the summer there. In the 1980s, a lot of sea ice there, and now the average picture is that you have less than half ice every year in September there, half of it already gone. And likely in a couple of decades, there'll be almost no ice left on the North Pole. Clear already demonstrations that our climate is changing. Now we switch to another subject I've been working on. This is climate change, and it's caused by, like I said, CO2 and other greenhouse gases. And we have the Paris Climate Accord of 2015, which is at least the first global step to do something about it. Another global issue you might have heard, especially in the 1990s, was very hot topic, was ozone layer depletion. Great pictures shown by NASA and by KNMI also shows you the ozone hole every October over the Antarctic, blue areas where 2/3 of all the ozone is gone. And why is that a problem? The ozone layer protects us. Ozone layer is between about 10 and 30 kilometers altitude in the sky, and it protects us from too much ultraviolet radiation. When you get too much ultraviolet radiation, you can get skin cancer and cataract. And so that's a very severe problem. But unlike for the climate now, where hopefully the world will start to act now with measures, for the Montreal Protocol, for the ozone layer depletion, the global community has already acted. In 1987, they signed the Montreal Protocol to protect the ozone layer. And the ozone layer is not affected by CO2, but it's affected by CFCs, which is the household name, the freons, they used to call it. They used to be in spray cans for deodorant, for hair, and they used to be in a lot of other applications. They are now globally forbidden by a global treaty. So it's a good example that a global treaty, where all the countries obey to, can work. So that's maybe a positive sign that the Paris Climate Agreement might also work. Now a bit more, because I said climate change and ozone layer depletion are two separate issues. And in first instance, they're separated. Ozone layer depletion is caused by CFCs in the atmosphere, and CFCs were first invented in 1931, I believe, by DuPont, and they marketed them as great compounds, not only used for spray cans, but also used for refrigerators, air conditionings, in large amounts, because they were really ideal compounds, easy to make, non-toxic, and could use them for a huge variety of applications, until we found out that they deplete the ozone layer. But of course, we still have refrigerators, and we still have air conditionings. What do we do now? We don't use CFCs anymore, we use HFCs. in there. And the first C there starts for chlorine. And the chlorine is what causes the ozone layer depletion. And the HFCs, which we now use, there's no chlorine in there anymore. So this is a very good step for the ozone layer. It protects the ozone layer. Then we start to use different chemicals. But the HFCs are potent greenhouse gases. And thereby, they contribute to climate change. And if you now continue to using HFCs, we went, well, to say a Dutch expression, from the drop to the rain, what is it? A nice... So that's a negative side effect of a positive treaty. The Montreal Protocol was very successful. We went into create another problem there. What have I done in this work? I've been following the Montreal Protocol discussions for the past 10, 15 years. This is a meeting in 2016 in Kigali. Does anybody know where Kigali is? Rwanda, the capital of Rwanda. The government of Rwanda wanted to promote the city and the country, so they hosted a meeting there. And I was sitting there in the back of the room. I'm a scientist, so I cannot do negotiations. So I'm sitting in the back of the room and trying to listen to the negotiations and trying to, in the corridor, trying to influence what's happening there. So as a scientist, I have my laptop with me there. And I do the calculations on the spot of the treaties they are negotiating. Now back to the HFCs. What I already, the past 2 years before I started, went to Kigali, I looked at these molecules. So this molecule is an HFC, which is in, if you don't have a very new car, but a bit older car, then this HFC is in your air conditioning in your car, for sure. And every car has an air conditioning, so you have this compound in there. And if it's in there, it's no problem. But in cars, it's very leaky always. So the things escape, and you have to refill it. And what escapes, that can affect climate. And why is it so bad for the climate? Because the radiation that gets from the surface, it likes that radiation. It's starting to vibrate on the nice radiation it gets. And then it radiates it back into space, but also radiates it back to the surface. And that's causing the extra warming. And one molecule, of course, is no problem. But if you find these things everywhere around the world, huge amount of refrigerators, and there are forecasts that we now have, I believe, globally down about 1.2 billion air conditioners in the world. And the projection is that in 2015, there will be four times as many, 4.5 billion air conditionings. And if all these air conditionings were using these HFCs, them can cause a big impact on climate. So what I've been doing, I'm making a model of the past decade. A model starts with, what's the demand for air conditioning? How many air conditionings and refrigerators we want to have globally in the world? How much HFC do you want to produce then? How much goes into the equipment, each of the different equipments? How much emission we get into the atmosphere? From that I calculated the concentration of the HFCs, how they grow into the atmosphere, and what warming that gives globally. And you make these kind of graphs. These very complicated graphs, the only one I will show you. No, I have another one. It shows you my projections from 2000 to 2050 of how the HFC emission would increase. You see now we have quite small values, but especially in China, India, and the rest of Asia, it's projected to grow very strongly. And now the units on there, that's in billion tons of CO2. So it's HFCs, but compared to the effect on climate, and therefore expressed in CO2. But what does 5 billion tons of CO2 mean? No clue, of course. You can compare it. It's the same effect on climate as 1,500 power plants have, fired by coal or gas. So only these HFCs we use in air conditionings. In fact, the funny thing is, so you use a compound which is meant for cool something, cool refrigerator of an air conditioning, and it causes global warming. So the amount of HFCs could have grown to about the effect of 1,500 power plants. And this could give you an extra warming, global warming, of 0.5 degrees Celsius by the end of the century. So a significant step of warming. What happened now after the negotiations started in 2009? I've been present at most of the negotiations. And after 7 years in 2016, the countries made an agreement. I was present there. I made with my iPhone, I made this picture there of the negotiation result at one of the meetings by the end of the day. And I went back to my laptop, and the same evening, when the negotiations were finalizing, I was doing the calculations of what the climate impact of what they were discussing, what it meant. And I showed this graph to the US delegation, European delegation, and it shows here that the big red curve is if you wouldn't do anything. If there would be no agreement, then the HFCs could contribute up to 0.5 degree warming globally by the end of the century. And now with the agreement, that dropped down to about 0.06 degree warming. It's by the negotiations, by 7 years of negotiations, they've avoided 3/10 to 4/10 of global warming by the end of the century. And the funny thing is, I showed this to the US Secretary of the Environment, and we discussed that if you look at the blue line, I drew it a bit thick on purpose, and in fact, they've been talking there the whole week about the thickness of the line, how thick the line is. The politician didn't realize that what they were negotiating didn't make so much sense. Now, it did make a lot of sense. But they were fighting if you had to reduce the HFCs a few years earlier or a few years later. And that doesn't make such a big difference. That was the message I was trying to tell them. You have to act, but if you act a few years later or a few years earlier, it doesn't matter so much. This, the thickness of the line is what they were discussing about for about a week. That's my role, I think, as a scientist, to put in perspective what they are doing. So the 0.3 to 0.4 degrees Celsius, we have to put in perspective with the Paris Climate Agreement. There they want to keep global warming between less than 2 degrees Celsius, or preferably less than 1.5 degrees. And of that 1.5 or 2 degrees, 1 degree, as you've shown you, is already reached. We are already 1 degree above the pre-industrial values. So we only have a half or 1 degree to go. And then preventing a few tenths of a degrees is significant. What I think was now the key to success here. I played a role as a scientist, publishing papers and communicating it to the policymakers. But also at the negotiations, industry was always present there. Because I don't make refrigerators, I don't make air conditionings. So industry has to come up with different solutions. And they are doing that. Already did it there. Of course, they were defending also their own industry, but also they were part of the negotiations, at least in the corridors, to come up with solutions. And of course, the deals are made by politicians. So we need politicians, we need industry, and we need scientists here. But especially we need people who have the vision, who want to act and want to do something good. So I think the people there, which are present there, were very important. I played the role there as a scientist, and that's also what I think the only thing what I can do. And I'm guided, I think, by what Carl Sagan always said, that science is not perfect. It can be misused, it's only a tool, but it's the best tool we have. It's self-correcting, it's ongoing, and applicable to everything. And that's my point of view. Science is a strong point. And if Mr. Trump doesn't understand it, that's a pity for him. But science will tell the truth, and science will correct him eventually. Thank you very much.